Dear participant and resource person, good evening to one and all here. And this is a webinar series. The main objective of the webinar is to promote mental health and well-being among the different participants, from childhood to old age people. And I found the most important person in the field, and who have contributed a lot in the field of mental health, and ma'am is one of them. I had an opportunity to listen to her presentation when I was attending the faculty development program at Rajasthan. So, in addition to that, I will talk about her research experience. And one of the renowned researchers, she is having collaboration with many countries around the world. And with us, Dr. Damantis Sandhu is there. She is going to share on the topic of mental health and online safety. Ma'am, I welcome you on behalf of the Department of Psychology and on behalf of all the participants over here. Please take the session and lead us through and share with your knowledge and experience with us. I welcome you, ma'am.
Thank you, sir. Thank you. It's a pleasure to be a participant in one of our series of learning, especially during these lockdown times. These kind of activities are very appreciable and they are the need of the hour. Thank you for giving me an opportunity to interact with my colleagues all over the world. So today's presentation or today's discussion is about adolescent mental health and online safety. We've been reading a lot about online issues, how cyber safety is of prime concern to our contemporary world. And at the same time, we know there are lots of challenges being faced by adolescents all over the world, and especially in India. Now, why adolescents? Why did I choose the population of adolescents? Adolescence actually is a stage of stress and storm. There's so many issues associated with this stage of life. It's considered as a stage of identity formation, a stage of stress and storm, and a stage of various biopsychosocial changes, which create a kind of an internal civil war between an adolescent. And this is a stage of identity formation where a child has to find an answer to the question, who am I? What's the real me? What is the direction and purpose of my life? There is exploration of sexual identity. And during this process, the child might even falter and might even ruin up or mess up his entire life to come. And there are challenges to his development by overconformity to peer pressure. And as we all know, there is heightened risk-taking because developmentally, he is being faced by the issue of personal fable. And the child has a feeling of invulnerability that wrong things can happen to others, not to me. Like even in today's crisis time, a typical adolescent might think that, yes, the virus might affect others. Others might be able to contract the virus, not me. So there's a kind of invulnerability in the children. So that compels them, that really encourages them, which I would say that is very unhealthy for them. And it leads them towards risk-taking behaviors. And India has a lot of young population. And it has more than 50% of the population, which is below the age of 25 years. So the whole attention of the policymakers has to shift towards this particular segment of population because they are our real treasure and they are the future of India. And most of the problems, I would say around 55 to 60% of the problems related to mental health or any mental condition, they start emerging or they start showing up their face by the time the child is 14 years of age. And all the people who are tomorrow going to have any mental condition, they start showing some problems by this age. So this is a very delicate stage of life. And we need to shift our attention to this particular population. So what are the various threats to adolescent mental health? So first of all, as we are all familiar with the quality of home life, the relationship issues with the parents, with the other family members, then the child's exposure to violence, whether at home or school. So they are the threats, they are the risk factors that might put a child or expose the child or create a fertile ground for a child to have various psychosocial issues today or maybe in the times to come. And there are fluctuating levels of self-esteem at this stage. The child might think very high of himself, very positive of himself today, but suddenly there would be dips in the self-esteem. And then there are relationship issues with the peers, not just of the same sex, but the opposite sex peers. So that might also propel a child towards risk-taking behaviors and even put him into depression or other psychosomatic issues. Then poverty is one issue, which is again a threat to the healthy adolescent development and mental health. And the biggest challenge the contemporary world is facing is increased access and use of technology. And in today's scenario, especially the times we are in, we are in that stage of life where we have to contradict all that we were telling the children earlier. We were telling them to reduce their screen time. We were telling them to use limited technology, so on and so forth. But in today's time, we are encouraging them to use mobile phones to connect to the world through internet, to gain knowledge to the internet. So we are at the time of big crisis. So parents are really inept at handling the kids and ensuring their safety, because it is important to ensure their online safety, because online world is a big world, and I don't shy from saying that it's a big bad world. Of course, there's, you can learn so much. There are immense opportunities for social interactions, for access to knowledge, but there are lots of harms and risks to the children, especially the adolescents who are still naive. Their cognitive capacities to think about themselves, to make rational decisions about themselves and their lives have not yet appeared. So as you can see this cartoon came in 1993 by Peter Steiner. And at that time, nobody knew that it would become or it would attain such huge importance and value today. So here you can see two dogs in a living room. And the dog on the floor, he's asking the dog on the chair, "Bro, what are you doing?" He says, "I'm working on the computer." And he says, "You're working on the computer? But you're a dog." And this black dog, he replies, "On the internet, nobody knows you are a dog." So this is the truth about the internet. This is the truth about the digital world. And because of this, our children are at risk. Because on the internet, there is a lot of anonymity. You do not know whom you're interacting with. And as they say, a meek lamb can become a big bad wolf on the internet because the other person is not able to see whom he or she is interacting with in real life. The other person could have assumed a pseudo identity. The other person behind the screen could be anybody. It could be a cyber predator, who could be a pedophile, who could be any psychopath or sociopath. Path, a person with personality disorders, or somebody just trying to make money by fraudulent ways, by doing economic offenses at all, etc. So my focus is now shifting to something called cyberbullying, which is actually a big threat to the well-being of adolescents all over the world. And earlier, on this slide, you can see that there's something called traditional bullying, which people like you and me, our age group, we have seen that, we have faced in our lives. And there used to be one big kid in the class, big in size, a kid who would flunk often, and he or she would steal other people's lunch boxes, and or who would just slap kids or try to kind of bully them, trouble them, threaten them, so on. But in today's world, you are practicing bullying by the use of technology, by the use of internet, and you don't have to be big and strong like the street bully or the school bully or the typical Gian, as the kids see in Doraemon, who's always trying to trouble other kids and Nobita and all. So you don't have to be big. In short, only you need is a smart brain, a brain who is very vicious, a wicked brain, and just a data pack, and with a click of a finger, you can disturb any child, you can threaten any child, you can bring that child to the verge of tears, bring him to a level where he starts hating going to school, starts developing depression symptoms, starts disliking certain classes, certain teachers because of its association with them, and so on and so forth. And to the extreme, even there have been cases where the kids, the children who have suffered online bullying, there are cases where it has led to cyberbullying. When they go to school, they pick a fight, especially when they know who the perpetrator is. So the online bullying or online threats have been translated into real life arguments, real life conflicts, and where the children have even taken up guns. And in the US, there have been a lot of shootings on the school. A number of shootings have taken place because of the wars which began on the internet and they were translated in the real life. So cyberbullying is basically, how we first of all define bullying. Bullying is basically imbalance of power. So one person is big, the other person is strong, and there is intent to harm and there is repetition. So in order to be called bullying behavior, they have to be three things: intent to harm, repetition, and imbalance of power. And in the context of cyberbullying, it is basically the use of technology to trouble, threaten, tease, or embarrass others. So the criteria is a little different here because the repetition part, number two part, if you can see, you don't need to repeat an act again and again, because even if you have done it once, that one-time activity, for example, if you have posted a photograph, a nude photograph of your ex-boyfriend or ex-girlfriend, or you have outed the chat, the intimate personal chat of your ex-boyfriend or girlfriend to the world, you've done enough harm, and that can be repeated by others. The other people can share that with their friends, and those people can share it further and further. So even one-time activity to threaten others, to tease others, to trouble others can be considered as a cyberbullying thing. And then if you talk about the number three point, the imbalance of power, here the imbalance of power lies in the anonymity. One is powerful not because of one's size. One becomes powerful because there is anonymity. You do not know who the other person is. So that sense of anonymity gives you a power of others. And definitely the first point is same as that of traditional bullying. There is an intent to harm. You want to do harm. So if the behavior is into these three, it conforms to these three points, that is considered a cyberbullying behavior. Now, as I was talking about, there are certain issues why cyberbullying is such a serious problem. And one is anonymity, as I discussed earlier. Because you are anonymous, people are not able to see you, your face. You can assume any identity. You can have a pseudo identity. So that gives you a lot of power to trouble others. Then there is 24/7 nature. So in the traditional bullying areas, what used to happen is that bullying used to remain within the school compound. If one child has kicked another, at least the child could go home and sleep peacefully and do the work, or maybe get some sort of, maybe he might have been thinking a little, but again, the child is in a bully-free environment. But now what happens is, if there is a fight in the school, it is recorded. The kids take out their cameras, they take out their phones, or even if it is not recorded, the moment the child goes home, logs onto the internet, at that time, maybe the bully, who is the real life, the school bully, might now use technology to continue the fight. So there is a lack of bully-free environment, and all the time, the child is under stress. So there is 24/7 threat to the child, and the child might get so worried to the extent that their people, their kids, adolescents who have committed suicide, because sometimes the harm is so much. As you see, so many cases of revenge porn. Just a few minutes back, I spoke to you about how the ex-boyfriends, the ex-girlfriends, or the rejected suitors, the rejected lovers, they post the pictures and videos. Children are so, they're usually very thoughtless while they're in a dating relationship. They keep on sharing their intimate videos or intimate pictures with their boyfriends or girlfriends, which can be used against them later. So those people with the vicious mind just to kind of take revenge, and we call it revenge porn. So these kind of situations, they have even compelled people to commit suicide. And there have been cases where I've been counseling cases. I have been counseling youngsters where their future relationships have been spoiled. Their future prospects of getting married have been spoiled because of this revenge porn and etc. And the next issue is, which I want to highlight, is why is cyberbullying or cyber threats, they are so harmful. There's something called disinhibition. One is disinhibited because of this cockpit effect. Cockpit effect is like if there's a fighter plane, the person, the pilot in the fighter plane is indiscriminately throwing bombs on the ground and he is not affected. Usually they don't come up with post-traumatic stress disorders as the people who have actually fought the war, because they have not seen the pain and anguish of the people they are throwing the bombs at. So similar is the case of cyberbully. The perpetrator, because he's not able to see the facial expressions of the person he's hurting, he's targeting. So the threat continues because he cannot see the pain of the person. And this is again a very serious issue because of something called the stranger on the train effect. Kids are usually very vulnerable at this stage of life. They usually share their thoughts to people whom they meet online, just like the way when you are on a train and you meet a stranger, you tend to tell everything about your life to that person, just thinking that this person is totally harmless to me. And you probably share so much which you would not share with your even with your closest friends. So because of the stranger on the train effect, one person, especially an adolescent or a young child, he or she usually builds up a very strong emotional relationship with the person online, somebody who has he or she has not met in the real world, probably thinking that, yes, this person understands me. And usually these cyber predators, they are so smart. What they do is they usually win the trust of the children and they validate the child's feelings. For example, the child would say, my parents are very mean to me, or my friends, they don't treat me well. They start earning the affection and the trust of the child by validating his or her feelings. So all this becomes very dangerous later on, because you have revealed a lot of information about yourself and you are putting yourself at a vulnerable position. Right, so the next, it is very relevant to study all this issue in India, because in India we have a lot and lot of internet users, and after China, India ranks number 2 in the number of internet users all of the world. And we need to understand the environment in which our kids are, because keeping in mind the future times and their access to technology, we have to understand their cyber behavior, and we have to design policies, and we have to find strategies, and we have to find ways. As psychologists, we have to see this problem from a 360 degree angle and even prepare ourselves for the aftermaths, that if the child has been cyber bullied, how well are we ready? How well are we trained to handle them? How can we handle the consequences, the mental health consequences of a child who has been bullied? So there's a lot of work which needs to be done in this area. So keeping in mind a number of factors, so how this study, which I've been doing over the number of years, how the seeds were sown. So we were inspired by this Ipsos survey, which happened in 2012. Around 18,000 adults were from 24 countries. They were surveyed, and it was found that 45% of Indian parents believed that a child they knew was being cyberbullied. 3 out of 10 parents in India say that their children have been victims of cyberbullying. And usually it was through social media like Facebook. And in India, the prevalence was higher than the Western countries and higher than US, Britain, France. And then there was the teens, tweens and technology study in 2015, in which they found that 13 to 17 years old spent over 5 hours on an internet in a normal week. And again, this is much higher than what the APA suggests. There are certain guidelines for the screen time and which the kids are totally violating. And 90% of the parents, they would monitor the activities. They feel, yes, we are monitoring them, but the kids are being very smart. they can hide their activities. The parents might think that yes, they are monitoring, they know what the kid is doing, but the kids themselves have admitted that they can befool the parents. They can, the parents can be totally unaware of what they are doing, and they can change their online activities in a jiffy. When they know that the parents are around, they know how to change the windows, everything. So they are smarter than the parents. And 27% of children knew other person's password. Now the children at this stage, they do not understand how serious it is to share your password with others. They think that probably it's a very simple thing, but we need to educate the kids that sharing your password with someone can land you in such a big trouble. And they have been even accessing other people's accounts. And then there was around 52% of the children who had bullied people over social media. So a lot of children have been bullied, and at the same time, they were the bullies. So there are two people involved in the situation here. One is the perpetrators, and the second is the bully victim. So bully victims are the people who have been troubled by somebody, and bully perpetrators are the people who are the bullies. They have inflicted harm on others. Just to add to it, there's something called bystanders also, which probably we will touch in some of our next talks. But they have a very big role to play. Just like in any social situation, the bystanders can intervene. So similarly, we have cyber bystanders also, who are the people who are witnessing all this happening. And they can actually either infuriate the whole situation or they can douse the whole situation. So bystanders play a very important role in the bullying triad. And there was a Microsoft Corporation survey in 2012 for the children from 8 to 17 years from 25 countries. And India was ranked third highest in cyberbullying. And 53% of Indian youth were victims of cyberbullying. And 50% admitted to bully someone else online. And it cuts across genders. Being a boy, being a girl, it's the same. You are equally at risk. Well, even if you're a boy, you are a girl. So there are the first few cases in India. In 2006, the schoolboys from Mumbai bullied their principal using the social network Orkut. And in 2007, there was a case which gathered a lot of media attention, the murder of Adnan Patrawala, a 16-year-old boy, where the Orkut was used, and he was murdered by his own peers. So cyber safety is the public health concern in India. And there's a dearth of research examining online behavior and cyber victimization patterns of children. And a risk and needs assessment approach can identify children at risk and design better interventions. Now, all the researches which I have been doing, this started in 2012. When we won the Indian European Research Networking Program, it was a grant by ICCR, ANR, NWO, DFG, and ESRC. And the participating countries were India, France, Netherlands, Germany, and UK. And it was India's first multilateral agreement on social sciences. So that's how we started working on the issue of cyber safety for children and the consequences of online threats to children, health, and well-being. Right, so the one of the researches which I wanted to highlight here is, while doing the project, we found that there is no specific Indian word which is equivalent to the word bullying. Like in our own languages, we have so many languages in India, but if I have to see that what is that one Punjabi word which can describe bullying or bullying behavior, or what is one particular behavior in Tamil, one particular word in Tamil which can describe this behavior. So there was no proper one proper word which would describe this behavior. So this study, which is published in one of our publications from Cambridge University Press, London. So we studied this word because it's very important to take this issue to the deepest part of the country, because that's where the problems are lying and we are totally ignorant. and even in rural areas, the children are bullying each other. But we cannot use the word bullying because English is not properly understood. We need to design the word bullying so that when we reach out to the school children in the rural areas, in the far-flung areas, in their own geography, we need to have a particular equivalent word for the word bullying. So the objective of this study was to translate the word bullying into different languages, and there were at least 7 countries who participated in this. And we used the 40 item version of cartoon test, where you show a stick like figures and you ask the kids, would you describe this as a bullying behavior or not? And we did the study in Punjab region and Tamil Nadu, because one of our partners, Dr. Suresh Sundaram, he was in Tamil Nadu. Right now he is in Rajiv Gandhi Institute for Youth Development. That time he was in Annamalai University. So we performed the study on 125 adolescents in Punjab and 150 on Tamil Nadu. And there were 3 words which were selected. In Punjabi, the word was dhakke shahi, pange lena, bar bar tang karna. And in Tamil, the 3 words which looked like equivalent were sintutal, keli, and tun puruttal. But finally, the findings were that from Punjab and Tamil Nadu, the findings were disappointing in the sense that all terms gave rather indistinct profiles. In Punjabi, however, out of those 3 terms, the most serious and the grave connotation was expressed by dhakke shahi, followed by bar bar tang karna. So in short, we could not arrive at one single word in Punjabi or in Tamil which could describe bullying, because we wanted that this term should reach out to people who are not the native English speakers. So from these results, it would seem that none of the Punjabi or Tamil terms is a very good equivalent to English bullying. So identifying a concordant term for bullying in Punjabi or Tamil was not really achieved in this particular study. So the next study, which these are all the studies in which I have participated in. So this study was done in collaboration with Professor Catherine Balaya from International Observatory of Violence in Schools in Nice, France, then Dr. Sundaram, then Kirandeep, who's one of my PhD students. She has finished her PhD in the area of cyberbullying now. So in this study, we wanted to investigate whether there are differences in digital uses, risk-taking and online negative experiences amongst children in India and France. And we used a self-report questionnaire adapted by Smith et al., Livingston et al., and Balaya. And the sample was taken from Tamil Nadu and Punjab. There were around 1,021 adolescents from India. And from France, there were around 1,312 participants. Mm-hmm. And yeah. The questionnaire composed of 7 set of questions. The ma'am, digital use.
Ma'am, we are having less than a minute for this session. We will sign in the same link again for the remaining session and group discussion.
Okay.
We are having less than a minute. I think we got a lot of information from cyberbullying and online safety and adolescent mental health. We'll come back again for the remaining presentation. In the same link, just click back and then come back. We'll have a 40-minute discussion for the same.
Okay, so should I wind up here?
Yes, ma'am. We'll continue here.
Okay, sir. Thank you.